one that's behind here. I just want to welcome everyone to tonight's Southwest Vermont Supervisor Union Policy Draft Committee. As usual, we're going to start at 4:30 start, and we're going to be completed by 6 o'clock. I'll go over the agenda items, and then I'll go over a few other things that I'd like to have us do and try to hold to in terms of structures of the meeting. The agenda items is for public comment, and is the first item down. And the second item we have down is Act 77 Proficiency-Based Graduation Requirement Information. And the third item is curriculum. Fourth item of professional development is an update on administrative procedures for that. Tracking sheets so we can know where everything is. We have down FYI just to make sure everybody realize we've completed information on appointment administrations other than supervisors in terms of the process of guidelines. And to let everybody know that there is and where things are in addition to the policies that we have here is the Vermont School Board Association website is being listed down so that you can take a look at those for those that love to do this thing on their own out there. So, item number 7 is others. The proper way to do this is before we start and really get any other policies or any other things on the agenda, I have to, at the opening of the meeting, ask, are there any others to be considered tonight in terms of the agenda? No. Okay, so the agenda order would be the one that we are going to stick with in the order because we have someone here to speak to us tonight. We'll do that. Before we get started, I wanted to make sure it was a question about the makeup of the board. And I just wondered, we did this at the very beginning. Annually, the SVSU appoints this board as the board to do the policies. And I took the representation from the SVSU and Dick France took it from SVSU, but then we represent different boards. The board makeup is to have someone from each of the school district areas like Mount Anthony and the High Middle School representation, the middle school, the principals coming front end to represent them and somebody from the high school to do that. We need high school, we need elementary, we need someone from the different boards, Pownell, North Bennington, Woodford. We need somebody from Shasberry to be in to help represent and make up the board. So those members, we ask to all come. We try to get at least one member from each one of those boards to be here, and those are the body of members. Now, we have members of the administration that come and we said, well, we need administration here because they're going to implement the policy, and we have representation from the administration. Normally, we do the things together. We like co-chair the administrations and the policy, even though they tell you the policy is the school boards. But we co-chair because it's very difficult to manage policies and procedures just separate. So we work very close together to keep the policies going. And to let everybody, you say, well, what happened out here? The SVSU, and to tell you right on their website, that all of the boards voted to unanimously join together and form a policy committee to manage the policy for the whole U.S. district. So that's SVSU district, and that's what we do along that line. So we take comments from the public. We take information from them and consider that, and that's what we'll do. And then we'll deliver all these things and make a recommendation in terms of a policy that goes before the board in terms of SVSU first, and then the other boards after that. And then we go through the cycle along that line. So the start of the meeting, I'm going to ask that we identify ourselves first so that everybody will know who we are. And if we're going to speak, I'd like for you to really identify yourself so that we can sort of slow it down. We only have an hour and a half, an hour and 20 minutes, and we're going to get around to these things. So we can start over on the side with Lisa. Is that?
Yes. Lisa Popowski, SVSU Administrative Assistant.
Hi, Donna Lee, Assistant Superintendent.
Sandy Foster, Woodford Principal.
John Bullock, North Bennington.
Holly
Banish, Asbury. Leon Johnson. We have, I'd say we did have name tags now too. Make it easy for the camera out there. Thank you.
Jackie Kelly, BSD.
Bruce Lee Clark, Career Development Center.
Dick France, Woodford.
Dave Barrow High School.
Frank Myers, SVSU.
And we have members from the audience, the public here. We have a guest speaker tonight. You're going to be in here. You can introduce yourself. So,
I'm Laura Boudreau. I'm the Director of Curriculum Instruction and Assessment for the SVSU.
Yeah. I'm Jeannie Jenkins. I'm a community member.
Larry Johnson, community member.
Okay. It was a question one asked, too. How do you get there? The ordinance. Every year, annually, we vote to say who wants to be the president or who wants to run or provide, be the person that's over this. And so I ask, and if nobody else wants to take it, I continually work it. Mm-hmm. And if I don't really take it, Dick France said he'll probably take it. So that's how, that's what we've done in the last number of years, I think we've done it that way. Mm-hmm. So if somebody else is out there. So now I'll take public comments, and what I like to do is have the comments all given to me, if you have a public comment at the very beginning, so when I start delivering things, I can sort of focus on getting them right through. So we have a comment.
Just a question, is it possible to have a list of who is officially on the policy committee on the SVSU website? And also, just so it is clear who's on the committee. And also, I'm just thinking that some people's emails might need to be updated on there. But it'd be nice to know who is actually on the committee.
I think that could possibly happen out there in terms of that. The individuals usually stay pretty constant during the year. Sometimes they don't, but. So, okay, we want names on the website. I don't see any problem with that. So, with that, then, with no other comments, I'd like to go into Act 77. Proficiency-based graduation requirement. We've asked the curriculum director to come here so that we can try to find out ahead of time what's coming down the pipe. So, you got it.
I pass that up. Pass this way. Thank you. So, I was invited to to start a conversation about Act 77, which is all about pathways. And I think the conversation started a little bit at your last policy committee meeting. Yes. So what I did on the cover page that I made for you, you have what the cover page. So we're bound to follow the educational quality standards. The most recent version was adopted April 5th, 2014. And the purpose is stated right there is that we're working towards ensuring that all students are afforded afforded educational opportunities that are equal in quality and enable them to achieve or exceed the standards approved by the State Board of Education. And then the next little section that you see is actually Act 77 has different components. And right now we're just focused on the part about personalized learning plans. And this little section is right out of the educational quality standards, and it requires that all of our students have personalized learning plans in grades 7 through 12. And this year, the law states that our 7th and 8th graders have to have personalized learning plans in place, and both our middle school and high school are working towards that. There's actually been a whole, and Frank can speak to that, at least more than a year involved in putting things in place. And the goal is that the student really drives the process, which is the really exciting part, and that school personnel are part of that process. And another really nice part is that the parents or the legal guardians of the children are also involved in that process, and that the plan must be reviewed annually. But the plan really needs to be well-rounded, so not only are you looking at the academic strengths of the child or the challenges potentially, but you're also looking at their interests and what they want to do, and it's a really exciting process to embark with a child. So that's kind of a little bit about what a personalized learning plan is supposed to contain. The back side is just, we are trying to give you information. This is another, I found this to be a lovely one-page flyer put out on Act 77 by Shaping Our Future Together, which is a group that has, and we actually do this year, have Mount Anthony students involved in the process of creating a communication plan for Act 77. But the part that's really important for today is in the third section, which is called What Will Learning Look Like, the middle of that paragraph is a really nice statement about what a personalized learning plan should be. It's a student's choice of his or her individual pathway that will be built on individual goals, learning styles, interests, and abilities. Each student, in partnership with teachers, parent guardians, will customize their own engaging, rigorous, and relevant plan for graduation. So that's what we're headed for. And then the next flyer I created using the Agency of Education has done a wonderful job of creating resources for us to learn how to create a plan to implement personalized learning plans. Not only have they placed the research behind why it's a good practice, but they've given us then some protocols to follow to do that. So So you can go to the agency, Vermont Agency of Education website, and you can use their search bar and put in personalized learning plans, and you will get a wealth of information. So now if we kind of narrow our focus to how does this impact policy. Last year, Frank Barnes and myself sat with high school and middle school staff, and we did a self-assessment that the state provided for us. And one section we looked at was the policy section, because there will be implications for local policy. And this kind of highlights what needs, the steps that we need to go through. They suggest that that there might be revisions that need to be made, and there is a chance that we might just need to develop a new policy to protect the PLP process. Local policy should outline expectations and provide the support and resources required for successful implementation. Hopefully the policy will help to provide clarity for all of our stakeholders. It will build in some enough flexibility though, so teachers can impart their own creativity in supporting students to develop their plan. And the hope is to really focus in on the most essential, that the policy would focus in on only the most essential components. And then the process is listed, and we're kind of just at step one. We're here to just engage the school board to understand conceptual framework in the PLP design. The next step is to actually review current policies that we already have that we might have in place that support this process, and that hopefully will also draw out where we need some updating or possibly a whole new policy. And then you can see the other steps that I know that you already go through when you're moving through a process. But these are all live links on the AOE website. So you can go to the AOE website, and they've really done a nice job of laying out what needs to be done. They also reference that they've worked with the New England Secondary School Consortium. There are many states, when you go to the website, many of our New England friends are doing similar work. And the beauty in that is we don't need to recreate the wheel. We can kind of share what we're doing. And I've really enjoyed that, and I think you have as well, that we've been given a lot of resources to access. I also gave you the link to our website, to the AOE website, where I got most of this information. And then the last thing that I'll share with you is, so all over the state of Vermont right now, school boards are figuring out, so what do we do? And so this is truly just a draft that was shared at our last curriculum directors meeting from the Southern Region, that it's just a draft. It hasn't been adopted, but it was just a district that's looked at some tools that are out there, and have created something that, you know, is something just to think about just for personalized learning plans. I will also let you know that I think within the last 2 weeks, South Burlington passed a proficiency-based graduation policy. I think it's one of the first in the state. And I haven't seen the policy, but the news reel that it was passed, it also exists. So it is happening, and it is a conversation throughout the state. So if I go back to what the intent of this presentation was, it was just to give you some more information, to kind of outline potentially what the process might be, and to think about what next steps you might like to have happen.
Thank you. Big
yes.
Questions?
Well, I got a ton of questions.
That's why we're here
and,
today.
Yeah, and Frank is also very much a part of the committee that I'm on, our SVSU Proficiency-Based Learning Committee, so he might jump in as well.
This is a policy that's going to be way over most of our heads. We generally write policies here and then pass them around for sacrifice. We're not equipped to write this policy. Is that something that you folks are going to contribute to? Does the state of Vermont have it in a model form?
So again, I think if you go back and investigate the AOE website, and they actually have it's a PLP policy, like what they want to have happen. They're kind of guiding us in the language. They've also linked us to other resources. The Great Schools Partnership is a resource that Vermont is heavily leaning on that does work all throughout New England, and they have sample policies all through their sites. But I think the beauty of this table that I'm looking at is you have representation from lots of stakeholders that could help. And yes, we very much are all wanting to be part of this process. So, yes.
The obvious thought I have is that there's a number of students in our system that don't have goals.
Mm-hmm.
That becomes part of the educational process, to set up something, and this may become part of our policy, to set up a situation where we can help those students write their goals. I mean, writing goals, identifying interests, and is a big part of putting this all together. It's going to be tricky, but I think it's going to be really useful and move us in a whole other direction as far as what the students are going to get out of it.
So we should be starting to research stuff online and that kind of thing, or we're.
I would really start with the Agency of Education website. I feel like they've been really helpful for us in terms of a starting point, and they've really tried to, I mean, they passed Act 77, and I feel like they've created a nice bank of resources that are already there for you, and we will continue to try to sieve out things that we think will really help your thinking and share them with you that have, like this little article really helped me focus.
So one of the things that, I mean, in terms of a policy, when I want to mix policy up with procedure, the policy is going to be fairly simple.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
you've already pretty much stated that we're going to have that all students through grade 7 through
yes.
12 will have a personal learning
yes.
plan. And it's going to be made up of such and such
yes.
a composition and so forth
yes.
along that line. And then the next thing behind that will be that that there would be administrative regs to implement that.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the part that will be following the guidelines
yes.
that the district is going to have in place and that the Act have in place.
Yes.
The reference associated with that will be Act 77 for us, but the policy piece won't be so long. It's just administrative regs. We wanted to make sure that if you run into something, in doing the Act 77, from a policy standpoint of view, there are some things that we may need to put in the policy
mm-hmm.
that to support the efforts that this is going to happen.
Yes.
Right.
And so it's no question to anybody are like that. And that's the kind of stuff that we're looking
yes.
for. Things that we really need to put concrete into the policy mm-hmm. that will support the whole in terms of personal learning program.
Yes.
I think that's right. exactly it.
Yeah. And I think it'll come right from the language in the educational quality standards, and the law itself has some really specific points to it.
Okay, yeah, come.
I'd like to know, will the students have a menu to choose from?
That's what makes me excited, is that they are trying to make this a process that opens the door to creativity. There's structure in the tools that they're providing. You know, it could be there's surveys or experiences. The high school does a wonderful job of providing, getting students out into the community, and so playing on those experiences to generate their dreams and then their specific goals.
For instance, if a student really wants to pursue some scientific types of classes,
yes,
and we're limited by the teachers that we have presently,
mm-hmm.
so they are allowed to choose virtual classrooms.
That's part of the law is making available those virtual spaces, virtual classrooms, virtual learning.
And will those virtual classrooms have limitations also?
To what degree, Jackie?
Well, for instance, higher levels of chemistry and biology, are they available right now?
Well, part of it goes along with, yeah, they are, because we have what's the initiative with high school,
virtual.
I mean, college courses.
Dual, so
there's another
yeah.
one too.
But they can also go and take college courses like at CCB.
Right.
Yes,
right.
So there's
right.
virtual
but
learning.
But at this meeting,
the Vermont Virtual Learning
yes.
Cooperative
right.
that I teach with. Yeah,
right. So
yeah. that one.
The
that
questions
one.
That you're asking is going to be a lot of the things that are going to be part of the regs.
Yes.
And that's all. We want to understand all those things, but for us, I want to just remind you, the first thing is to put a policy in place that says this is going to happen, how it's going to be made up, and then we'll look at the things that are happening out here within the structure of the organization 6 through 12 that may need to be pulled out to put strong emphasis on the policy if necessary, so that we can say that this is going to happen a certain way, some of these things that you may need to say out there. Bruce?
Well, yes, I think we need to be, all the board members need to be brought up to speed on what is available and how does that work. I think that's absolutely
mm-hmm.
essential,
mm-hmm.
Both in terms of the options that kids have now, but also what could we be doing in the future. That's part of what I was doing last week in Kansas or Oklahoma City. But it's not just writing a new policy, it's also looking at the current stuff, such as 6000 or the graduation requirements policy. I think there's, as I recall, there is one there somewhere.
Yeah,
and those are going to be, we really need to radically look at those, because the curriculum policy goes on 4 pages, but was written at a time when we were not thinking this way.
Right.
And so it would seem to me that has to be
yes.
either ditched, which is possible,
yes.
or drastically rewritten in a much more open textual way. But in the meantime, board members need to be really clear about what options are out there for students
mm-hmm.
To be able to choose how to craft their high school education. It's not going to be like anything we've really seen
mm-hmm.
before. It's not going to be seat time.
Mm-hmm.
That's really critical. We're going to be talking about competency, the capacity to actually do things
mm-hmm.
that will help us. So I would say, Leon, it's not, I would want to
I agree.
Say it's more than just drafting. It really is looking at what we have, and I would hope that we would, this body, since we're probably as knowledgeable about what's in the policies as anybody, could enlist a small group of people to go through, perhaps with some administrative help, to go through the current policy and say, okay, we need to start working on this one. We need to start working on this one,
mm-hmm.
and this one,
mm-hmm.
and this one, and see what we end up with. I have no idea what the list will look like.
You're offering such a nice preview of our meeting.
This is.
That's the agenda.
I couldn't tell that from the agenda.
Well, we've had prior discussions, so you're just right on the mark.
I'll hold that because that's exactly what was going to happen later on, was to say, you know, we need to have a few people working specifically on this particular piece out here start to formulate the parts together so that we can see them in a policy form here and the other things. I looked at grade advancement and retention and so forth out there. I'm saying that's one that we know we got to, that's going to be affected by this. Mm-hmm. And then the curriculum is, we know that that's going to be affected by this. And so that's why some of these things are here. So this is a good, healthy discussion.
It's a start.
It's a start.
I was wondering whether some type of assessment of just even the policy would be included in this too. For instance, if we go through the year next year and then we find kind of some kind of slippage or some kind of part that is not working, and can it be brought back to the policy?
Oh yes, it's most definitely. Any time that we have the policy, if we find that they're in the process, and that's what I'm saying, if there's policy, there's pieces that we need to strengthen and make concrete to make things work or remove, they come back. Mm-hmm. And this is how the part of the policy review process takes place.
Well, usually it's 5 years, so I guess I was wondering if this policy could come back in a year.
It'll come back as when needed and as fast as we need to get it back here to look at it. And that information we'll find out from Laura, we'll find out from community members too, that certain things is not quite the way we think they need to be, and the administration would say, look, you know, I'm having some buff about this, and I'm saying, well, we can fix that. We can bring it here, and it becomes the policy and the law, and everybody that's affected will be required to be a part of that, whether they like it or not. That's the way it's going to be. So I just wanted to keep us in mind that we're going to keep on going. I want to thank the Lord for bringing that. It's good to have the discussion, and we hope to see you again.
Absolutely. I'd love to come back. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Laura.
Okay. So this will be back on as an item for forming a list of people to work on that for next time, for times out in the future, just an active thing. The next policy on here is policy number 6000, curriculum policy, and Bruce started to say a few words about that.
Drafted in the old days.
It was drafted in the old days, and I thought we had looked at it, and it was short, supposedly a short paragraph.
That was the CDC's curriculum policy.
Oh, was
it?
Yeah. If you look on our website, it's remarkably short.
Yes, ours here is a remarkably short new word.
Because it was too long. What was there and what's on there now is administrative regs. It's mostly administrative regs.
I agree.
So, who wants to? Donna going to?
Sure, I can introduce this.
Okay.
And exactly as you're saying, Bruce, I love the way you've introduced all our topics right in just a short little speech there. We had a policy that was policy 6000 that was 9 pages long, and that really included a lot of verbiage about different aspects of the curriculum instruction and assessment. It really was not written as a policy. It was written, like you said, as a kind of a combination of administrative regs and policy, which makes it very difficult to update, as we have found. So this is really a model policy that was offered by the Vermont School Board Association. It's just very clear about where does the curriculum come from. It is established by the SVSU Board of Directors and the Superintendent. And I'll just give you a few minutes to read it. It really is to just say what the curriculum is and who is responsible for developing it and maintaining it.
Mm-hmm.
It does not go into all the details of how is that implemented in every building. That is part of administrative breaks.
Right.
So, give me a couple minutes to just read it.
Does anyone else have some to talk about while it reads?
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Does this become part of this?
Okay.
So
my
question is the Act 77, does it become part of this curriculum policy? Is it incorporated in it? Because
I mean, the thing that we're discovering more.
Yes.
Well,
yeah, I mean, basically, I would say Act 77 is able to be incorporated because we've moved to a much more
open
text
and so that
kind of
possible.
Curriculum. So that you,
right.
Yeah, so we're not going to have to rewrite this every single time the state comes down and says, oh, you've got to do X, you've got to do Y, you've got to do Z.
So my question is,
right.
Is this new draft, the draft that you've got,
right.
Would it cover what Laura is talking about? In
not
the
entirely. Not in its
not
entirely.
Entirely.
No, and that's the wording that would may need to be changed in there and say that. If we're not going to have it
that
separate,
wouldn't be in curriculum.
It may not
I,
be.
I would be suggesting that there would be a separate policy on personalized learning plans, and that there would be another one on graduation requirements.
Yes.
You see what I mean? Because there are lots of parts of Act 77 which become obligations for the school districts. And so it seems to me we need policy that helps undergird and support each of those initiatives. And the two main ones are personalized learning plans and I always use the word competency, and that's not the right word.
Proficiency-based
graduation requirements.
Right.
So
technical education has been doing competency-based education for years,
mm-hmm.
and it's essentially the same thing. So it's proficiency-based graduation requirements rather than Carnegie Unit graduation requirements,
yes.
which is what we are all used to.
That's
so,
right.
So to clear this while everybody's still reading. The district, the SU, is going to have a curriculum policy.
Mm-hmm.
But all these things that we just talked about, so the curriculum policy is going to give administrations and things the authority to implement education
yes.
out here. And then you're going to say, what about the education? And you're going to say, well, as part of that, we're going to have Act 77, that how we're going to be doing it. I mean, but we don't have to put that all in here right now. It's just saying that we're going to, the board authorize the superintendent, his or their designee, to organize a committee incorporate reviews and develop a curriculum for the supervisory unit. So we're going to do that. And now that curriculum will be Act 77 of the requirement, personal learning plan. So now that's got to have a separate policy piece over here that we're saying we want to have that's going to ensure that we abide by the state regulations or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're saying, well, in there, and I'm not sure all the things that's in there, that's just dealing with personal learning plan. But the next piece out here is promotion and retention and so forth along that line.
Mm-hmm.
We got to look at that and make sure that there's not a conflict between that
right.
and what's new
mm-hmm.
here.
Right.
And there's some other things out there that may need to be tweaked.
Oh,
so that's the stuff that
there's
yeah.
a bunch.
Yeah, there's
my
a bunch.
Suspicion is that there is a bunch.
We're
so,
just starting the conversation.
Right.
I would point out that there were, you know, you're reading it. I would point out a couple things that are sort of hinting at the development of the Act 77.
Yeah.
One line is,
what's the number?
Well, it says, first of all, it says will continually develops and modifies curriculum lines 9 and 10
mm-hmm.
to meet or exceed standards established by the Vermont State Board of Education.
Right.
So that gives an open-ended, whatever they change it to is what we need to be doing. So that we're not defining every time they make a change. Like if they change science
right.
standards to next generation science standards, it doesn't mean we have to change the policy to
right.
say next generation science standards. It means whatever is the most recent.
Right.
And then, for instance, on line 30, it has as one of the references, the Vermont State Board of Education Education Quality Standards, Section 2120.5. So it has a up-to-date reference on what are the expectations for us to develop curriculum. This does not spell it out purposely so that we can continually develop and upgrade. Then there was one other line that starts to speak to this, line 14 and 15.
Yep.
It says, each school shall enable students to engage annually in rigorous, relevant, and comprehensive learning opportunities that allows them to demonstrate proficiency.
Right.
That's
right.
A new concept that we mm-hmm. are looking at. How does each student develop their proficiency?
Right.
So that is a part of our curriculum development.
So with those words, they cover these things that we're just talking about out here. So
bigger ideas.
Yeah, right. It's a bigger idea. Mm-hmm. SVSU is because we're saying 6 to 7. Just remember now, we want to not forget K through six out here still falls under the same curriculum policy piece. Mm-hmm. And so they're out here, but then those
newer standards.
The newer standards are going to be addressing your older kids, and we got the kindergarten, the preschool, we got stuff coming on out there in that area. Mm-hmm. So, but this curriculum policy is one that we need to just make sure that it allow all of these other things to happen.
And speak to them in rather specific ways.
Right.
There's another line in here, line 16, 17, 18. As required in 16
yep.
BSA 2902, each public school shall provide support for students who require additional assistance in order to succeed or be challenged in the general education environment.
Mm-hmm.
That
right.
means that is not just special education, that means every student gets supports to
right.
become proficient and be challenged. Right.
Okay. So, what do we need to do now with this if we want this next step? Yeah, I mean, we brought it here so that we can look at it and says, well, we know the other one is really not what we want.
Right. I couldn't edit it. To be
yeah,
right.
you couldn't
yeah,
edit it.
I tried.
Was, no, no. Did you actually try?
I did try.
Yeah.
I wish you had spoken to me earlier because it's not possible.
I learned that rather quickly.
This was drafted back in our early days yeah. of doing curriculum work as a supervisory unit.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's we are now in a very different time.
So do we, I mean, I'm trying to, the action here for this particular piece now, I mean, we got introduced to this and so forth. What does the board, the group feel like what we need to do next here with this? I mean, you think we've gone through it enough, if we think it's ready to say, let's just put it out or we want to bring it back next month, and after we've had a chance to think about some of the other things, we need to process the curriculum piece to start moving. Because this needs to take the place of the old one.
Yeah.
If we think we have enough here, we'll be able to say we can take this on to go to SVSU with it as a draft or warning. Or Frank has a hand up over here. And
I think it's almost ready as it is, but line 7, it just identifies textbooks and supplies. Excuse me, and it really needs to mention like open educational resources, especially since there's now a department at the federally Department of Education that addresses that. So other resources other than just textbooks and supplies need to be addressed.
Mm-hmm. So it needs to have some changes there in terms of for the selection and approval of textbook and supplies and open educational resources
and the colleges were
Dave just suggested in my left ear something, you know, just something like another resource, other, you know, educational resources or something. It doesn't, we don't have a real
in-depth,
right.
We so
need to
allow
for that.
That's the problem making.
So my question was, do we wanted to do something now or wait and bring it back next?
I don't want to wait.
Okay, we don't want to wait. So can Lisa, can we pull it to start making some changes in here now then? If that,
yeah, because we can
We can do it.
If we can perfect it now, we could move it on tonight, and I think that's necessary.
So on line 6 or 7, somebody had, Dave had some...
Did you have some words you wanted there?
You can combine up the resources unless you want to say it. You want to say educational resources?
Well, if you just say resources and eliminate textbook and supplies, then it...
And it also applies to technology.
Yeah, I think we need to be...
Well, I think it's more than just supplies. I think it's learning opportunities.
No, just resources. Instead of textbooks and supplies. Instead of those two words, just...
Textbook and supplies.
Jackie makes a good point with saying learning opportunities, though, too. Because we are taking it outside. It's not just...
That would still be a resource.
Right.
No.
You don't?
No, I think that's... I understand that you could see it that way, and I would not disagree. But I think it's nicer to be able to say, we're talking about more than just things. We're talking about... It's like the difference between...
Persons.
Yeah, we're talking about opportunities at CCB, opportunities on online education, opportunities at career tech centers. We're talking about all kinds of different learning and educational opportunities.
So, okay.
That's key.
So the wording that we need to put it to is removing textbook and supplies and to go into educational opportunities.
And other educational opportunities and resources.
Yes, we want the word resources in there.
So
resources and educational.
Okay, we'll have resources.
Yeah, I would say resources and educational resources and opportunities.
Yeah, looks good.
She did.
Is that what she did?
All right.
That looks great. Can we get rid of the number one at the top left-hand corner? I couldn't figure out what that was a number one for. On line 3.
Right at the top with my green.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, right there before the. No, not there.
On line 3. There's a number one.
Right there.
I have no clue.
Okay.
Me neither.
This is why is the draft coming in.
Yeah.
What's next now? You went down through. Is anything else that anybody feel the need to...
Is it necessary to reference Act 77 and any other references?
I would.
It is referenced at the bottom.
It is referenced, and here's the thing. I understand we're all used to talking about it right now as Act 77, and that's how Vermont talks occasionally about particular acts.
Right.
But they get codified into actual parts of the Vermont statutes, and that's why you use the statutory references, not acts, because there will be an Act 77 this year, and there will be an Act 77 next year.
Right.
So it's Act 77 of 2015 is the actual, how you would say it, and that becomes too big. So it's actually referenced there as part of the Vermont statutes.
So are you all set with that then?
I was just, instead of saying Vermont Law Title 16, Sections, blah, 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 put it the way it was put up above, which is 16 VSA sections, and then put that. You see what I mean?
You want the 16 VSA.
It should say 16 VSA sections. So there's two section symbols.
Okay.
There is a way to do this. Yeah, just like that.
Yeah. But we don't want the 2902.
We should have 2902 down in the references too.
In the reference.
Okay.
Lisa did make copies of these of the full standards, educational quality standards, just for your reference. They're a little hard
just
to
in
find
case
online,
I want.
And it's kind of nice to have them on paper to look at.
We can take them since you made the copies of them.
Yeah. Well,
okay.
I like them online. I like them paper.
I like paper when you're looking at a big document.
So
save this. It's for you. It's very special.
Anything else now we want to move on down to?
I'm just going to suggest something.
Okay. We got a suggestion coming up.
Since the policies direct the school how it's run through school boards, would anybody find any value in using action words like it says the SVSU Board of Directors has? Would anybody find any value in using shall be? Shall.
What line are you reading on?
Very first line.
Shall be responsible? Is that
shall be responsible and have authority.
And be the authority.
Be the authority?
Yes.
Just my suggestions. to be.
I actually like that better. It's more active.
Well, it's not. It's.
Well, I mean, it's a question.
Better language.
It's no problem with that. That's so you wanted the head to go to will.
No.
Shall have response.
Shall be
responsible. Be that's right.
And have authority.
And be the authority. I like
and
even
be?
Better. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's much more powerful language.
Yes, that's what we wanted. With
and then on six.
Line six.
Superintendent will be.
Yes, responsible. Yes, yeah. Will be. Is responsible for the selection of. Instead of having the responsibility, is responsible for. Is.
Okay.
Or something
that's
like
line
that.
Line six after designee.
Yeah.
Is the designee is responsible for
selection
and
approval of.
Okay.
And then what we added.
Okay.
To support the curriculum. Good drafting.
Yeah, this is.
Yep.
Okay.
Also in line 15, I think you should take the S off a while. Subject subjective opportunities.
15.
Okay, you got that?
Yeah.
Thanks, Dave.
Yeah. Anything else out here that somebody's looking at? This is a time to take up.
On line 14?
14 is.
The word annually seems odd. I mean, I understand what it's talking about in terms of the 77, but as a standalone document. It doesn't seem to make sense.
How about we say regularly?
Regularly or ongoing or something that indicates it's a continuous process.
I think
so each school shall enable students to engage annually in rigorous.
Engage, actually, because we don't need to say this here. Yeah, we can take the word annually. Because we're going to say something in a.
Right.
In the regs about when it's going to be.
Right. That's good.
And we may have another actual policy about
so that
PLPs.
Just
right?
To strike
and
the word.
Say that they're annual.
Yes.
Yeah, take out A.
Done.
So
we're going to engage in rigorous and relevant and comprehensive learning opportunities.
That allow them to demonstrate
proficiencies. Okay. You can't argue that. Let's, anybody else out here?
Did a pretty good job of sacrificing that one.
Yeah. can we
yep.
actually on line 18 get rid of the passive voice?
It
says it shall be the responsibility of the superintendent.
It is
the responsibility.
No, it should say the superintendent is responsible to hold each school in the SVSU accountable. Make it an active verb.
Okay.
Not a passive voice verb.
Okay.
When you start a sentence with the letter with the word it, which is what lawyers do all the time when they want a weasel.
We're so glad we have you here.
Okay.
Well,
that's who wrote that.
We were taught this, by the way, when we did legislative drafting.
Passive
voice is a weaselly way of getting at something.
Okay.
It's much better to say the superintendent is responsible to hold each student or can you know whatever.
So okay, I can be responsible.
No,
I don't like that language, but I'm.
A superintendent.
Will hold each school. Yeah, don't even need to say is responsible. The superintendent will hold each school in the SVSU accountable to follow the curriculum developed.
And that's because we've
policy.
Already named him up at the top to be able to
or
do
her.
So.
Or
him,
her.
Or her. I'm sorry. Yes. We've already named that position.
Be careful.
Yes, I'm sorry.
I'm sure you are.
So, is that clear now, the way that's read up there?
I like that better.
Okay. The superintendent will hold each
school. He will hold each
school,
yeah.
Okay. Anything else as you go down through this? This is
we are perfecting this document.
Dick has said he put it right out there.
Isn't it nice that it's only one page?
Yeah. And
substantially better.
Yes.
Does that mean you'd be working on the administrative regs to?
Oh, for the rest of our lives.
For the rest of the.
Oh, I think, well, I don't think you can, I think, yes, there will be a lot of administrative regs, but there will be at least, I can envision at least two additional policies that are not here yet.
Okay, so.
6001 and 6002.
To move this on.
A serious grammar question on line 10. Should it be develop and modify, or develops and modifies? I'm going back and forth in my own mind about it, it sounds funny as well.
Supervisory union.
Sorry.
I think it's fine.
It is that.
Singular.
It is a singular, the supervisory union is a singular subject, therefore they.
Continuously develops.
It modifies, if you could put it that way. Does that make sense?
It develops and it modifies.
Yep.
Okay, so we okay to let that stay just like it is?
Okay.
So.
Good.
That mean this is ready to go out to SVSU.
For.
For one.
Congratulations.
Well, thank you. Okay, so this will give us the right to start doing all these other things out there.
Lisa, would you do us a favor and send us via email a copy of this document now as we've modified it?
Yes.
So I have that electronically?
Okay. She can do that. I think so. Is that
I know
okay?
She can.
Just before you close it out, I'm not sure if this is a question for other or here, so I'm gonna.
Okay.
Because we're talking about personalized learning plans.
So this is related to the curriculum piece? Okay.
We're in the personalized learning plans referenced was this that you passed out. We're talking about curriculum to. For yearly, you know, for adequate proficiency to within the school quality standards that you there's an action for the board that I've been waiting to get clarification on this for a while.
Okay.
Under continuous improvement plans, which curriculum would fall into that, I would assume.
Can you point to where you are? What page?
This is on the.
It's 18. Page 18. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Might not be. It might be another area, but I didn't want you to close out.
So you wanting the board?
It says within this, the statutes, that when it wouldn't be the curriculum policy, but the action plans that have been given to us for. The board shall approve the plan.
Right.
Which means, to me, means a vote to approve the plan, correct?
Well, when we approve the policy,
this is, I'm talking about action plans.
Well, we're not going to approve each individual action plan, personal learning plan, no.
I'll finish my question otherwise.
Okay. All right. Well, then we're all set to move on with this and we'll move.
Could I the language is still bothering me on my line. One quick point.
Okay.
Could we change the beginning of that sentence from it is the policy of the board that the, to just the Southwest Supervisory Union shall continually develop and modify its curriculum? Cut out a lot of the stuff that's just cluttering up the sentence.
What's wrong? We need to. It is our policy to do this.
It's a policy document. So we're stating the policy. Do we need to state it's the policy in the policy?
No, that's a tendency that the School Boards Association drafters like to say, but it is not necessary.
But it's all over.
I know. We do it all the time.
It's everywhere.
It's format.
Okay. I just wanted to put that out there.
It is.
Yeah.
It is. It's a habit.
I want to change it here and agree to start trying to change it for that very reason. And yes, it is the policy. Then I need to edit all of the policies.
Or as you reconsider.
Not today.
But not today. Okay. So. We'll move it on. If everybody can live with this, this will be one going to SVSU. And in dealing with what we said we were going to do at 6:30, we only have 1 minute left.
No, it's only 5:30, Leanne. Don't look at that. Nobody's come in to change the clock yet, Leon.
Oh, you got me. I'm
so
good.
So we're going to go until 7.
So we're
by that clock.
By that clock up there. Okay, thanks. I was worried. I've been looking up there, and I really was. So, thanks. We're going to next is policy 4120, professional development update in terms of ministry.
I think that one was deleted, Leah.
We've taken care of the what the concerns
off.
Were.
Right.
Okay, so we don't need to do anything here. We did want to get to our tracking sheet so that everybody would know what that looks like and how we try to track all of these things. We've gotten several of them to move, and the tracking sheet will be coming up. And this is the system that we have in place to try to keep track of where all the policies are once they leave this board, and what boards have them, and what dates, and whether they table them, have comments, and anything along that line. And you can see, I can't quite read it from here, so somebody's gonna.
You can make a statement.
You wanna see
it? Oh, I didn't. I didn't print the copy out. Thank you. So on this, the first policy on here is anaphylaxia, and it's going back to the nurses group for review. I thought they went back to them, and they did, and it should be moving on.
But I don't think they came back to us. I think they collected together as a group, but I didn't think they came back to us.
I will verify that and have an update next month.
Okay, because the question is, this should be back and gone through the process for adoption. It did in some places out here, but it was held that BSD wanted to have some questions with them, and they didn't. Well, I don't know. I thought there was no changes made, is what I thought. So if that's the case, we'll be ready to put this back in place. So Lisa, you're going to check, is mm-hmm. what you're saying? Okay. The next policy on his is 5156 is student nutrition and wellness, and that's it's going around right now out. So we just I see it's over here. So it is. It's just it has proper dates in here, and it's going to go around. So that's moving along. I don't know that anybody's had any problems with it. I mean, I met at Mount Anthony, and they didn't have any issues yet. So that's moving along. We said professional development, and we said we didn't need to have this on here now because we knew what it was there, and that's okay. Background checks and record checks, 4,080. That's, I don't know why
that
was
on. Why is that
on? Why is that on? Because we didn't do it. This is in place, and we haven't made any changes to that, unless it's just, I don't know who asked or anything. We had search and seizure, and we took care of that, but background check, it wasn't anything to put out there for that. I don't know.
Have we looked at it in a while?
I don't know how to put this. It took 12 years to get it through the first time.
We're not going back. No, we won.
I have a former student who has now graduated and has worked out of the community for a number of times who drafted this way back when.
Yeah,
I'm just trying. There is no change in the statute, and there is no change in the requirement. I was trying to figure out. This was basically following the process that the statute lays out. I'm trying to.
We were trying to go back and review some of this stuff.
I understand, but
I think that might have been
what
it is. So
maybe we need to do it.
Right now, is no action. So
take that up.
Yeah. Unless something happens.
Computer network and internet. That's going around right now, and so I don't know of any problems out there that's come up with that. It's going through the process.
Right.
Appointment of administrators other than the superintendent, that's now
that can actually, will actually come up because it's
off.
Just the admin regs.
Right.
Right. And they'll be put up, do we put the administrative regs on the website or not?
Yes. The pieces that are there are tied to the administrative regs.
Right.
So we can look at that. I illustrated that on TV the other day when
we
pulled up one and showed the regs were attached right to
that.
I followed that. So the next one here is in the process. That's 5004, which is the prevention and harassment and hazing and bullying. That's the one that's taking the place of the 502, 503, and 588. And it's going around, and I don't think, there's been no comments that I know of from anyone and have any questions on that.
I have a question concerning that one and another one of the policies, because by the time the next policy committee comes around, those will have been worn by everybody.
Right.
Do we need them to come back to the policy committee?
If there is no changes out there, then we're going to continually with the process.
Okay. If there's nothing in the minutes where there was discussion or concern
at any of the boards, then we're going to keep moving.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Personal use of wireless communication. I think that's all done too. Mm-hmm. That should be off. So that was all done.
Yeah.
School billing enrollment zone. Oh, that was BSD. BSD had some discussion there at 3106. I don't know that they made their changes out there in terms of, it was a question about rezoning or something, but I didn't get any recommendations or something from BSD on that, or from Rick in terms of the bus route, or from the superintendent as to whether the buses will be running on certain roads versus something else. So,
do we need to get involved in that at all?
No, I don't.
No.
No. So that's no action, and we'll just take that one off too.
Okay.
Search and seizure is going through, and it just made it back through Mount Anthony, I know, and out there, and so it's up now for SVSU 11.
It went last week.
That's right.
As far as I know, it was approved.
Yes, it was
by SVSU. Wait for the minutes.
Yep.
It was.
I hope so.
Okay. The next one is 4003, bullying prevention of adults. Sent to legal review for that.
Right.
That question came up, and that was supposed to go and ask legal whether it made sense or not. And I thought we got some information back on that. Did it come back out? I thought, maybe I got it wrong, but the question was, is whether it was necessary to have anything in there when it came to adults versus the students because of the teachers and everything goes on, the different contracts and different ethical things out here. And that was the only adults that we were talking about, because we have substitute teachers and we got to hire people that have a contract and have something else out here. And I think the question was to go and see whether it was necessary to do that, and I thought we got an answer back to say it didn't make sense to have that. Can we follow up with that again?
Yeah.
I don't know the question, so I don't know where.
I do. It was brought up, just what Leon said. It was brought up that whether somewhere in the policy it should talk about teachers harassing students or bullying students.
Right.
Legal, told us that we should not.
Right, and the reason I'm saying I think we got that answer back was that everybody that we hire in the district and even volunteers and subs and so forth has a clause or have something to address that with them, and there's no need to try to get the policy out here to talk about that in an individual policy. That's what I think the answer was.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes.
And I think they said it's in the ethical standards and code of conduct.
It is, right, absolutely.
So if, I'm gonna say, let's take that off.
Okay.
And, because I think that's what we got, it just need to be off.
Yep.
Okay. The next one is 5065, verbal physical assault of an employee.
These may have been ones that were just going to be looked at to see if anything needed to change.
Okay. So.
These are addressed in the annual compliance tutorials training that everybody takes. So
we need to go ahead and just read it at this one and look at it.
Do you want them on the agenda for next time?
For next time.
Okay.
Okay.
Those three at the bottom?
We can do those three at the bottom, weapon prohibition and fundraising out
and
there.
Just
we
to
had
add
enterprise
to the fund, Bruce, where are you going to look in? What was that one called where it was?
Enterprise.
Oh my God, yeah. Enterprise funds. Yeah. I was hoping everybody would forget that.
Well, I think that part about fundraising may just triggered that.
Okay, enterprise funds. We couldn't find it. Actually, I can tell
you
what we...
You have one, don't you?
No, we do not, because we're still working on trying to get... I hate to pass... this is going to sound snarky, and it's not intended. We're trying to get the accountants and the folks from the state who are talking to us about enterprise funds. These would be funds that I don't even see any other school doing. When we, like say with Culinary Arts, runs its cafe... it's going to earn money. That's what we mean by enterprise funds.
Uh-huh. Right.
So these would be funds that student activity actually earns. I'm not sure I can think of any other place other than the CDC where that happens.
Well,
but other than the CDC, but the CDC is not part of the SVSU. So
it's in the federal regulations about financial management.
But nobody can come up with language which makes any kind of sense to anybody else. So right now,
just pull it right out of the regs.
They're fighting above us. That's all I can tell you is that
the CPAs
and the accountants are trying to come up with some language which we could then encourage. But I don't think you're going to need an enterprise fund policy here unless you...
if I can remember right,
it's more about our students and our...
something that they sold.
Yes, and it was right, and it's...
Rick was saying, let them at the top fight over it and come out with something right now.
Boy, am I glad you did, huh? But now I know I can remember exactly where we were. I left it with the accountants.
Okay. But we're just going to look at fundraising at this without enterprise.
I mean, if you just wanted a policy, there is clear language in the federal regulations. Financial accountability.
Sure.
Right.
But
I
the
can
problem
just
is.
Take that
sure, but the problem with doing that is that that the moment they change those regs, which they can do at any time.
Yeah.
Then you're sitting there with a policy that doesn't match the federal regs. So that's why we're trying to come up with something
bigger,
more open textually.
Okay.
Doesn't each school have their own little fund too?
Well, this is different.
This is different.
The enterprise fund is a fund where the class are. The group is being funded by public money, using public money, and as a result of that,
to make a thing, to sell it.
And then they sell the thing.
And now what do you do with it?
And
you have to actually pay the feds back. I mean, this is more complicated than we're making it, but it is. We're trying to do is make sure that the taxpayer is always made whole. In practice, we are doing that. The question is, what's the policy language which we would want to say? And right now, above me, the accountants at the state level are talking about what kind of language that would be. And when they make a decision,
they'll communicate
it to us.
That's what we're doing. So we won't go any further with that.
Okay.
All right. So... off that list, We have some things to go on the agenda for next time. And so are there any other items that need to go on? Well, this, we have some, the curriculum will go on this tracking sheet out there. We have FYI in terms of the administrative, other than the supervisor hiring, in terms of those procedures. That is, should be attached now. Is that the concern emphasis in terms of the process that's following that policy is now on the website? Is that correct? And in the administrative reg piece is attached to that? Is that correct, Lisa?
Not yet, but will be.
Okay, it's going to be there. It went through the personnel committee, met with the superintendent to go through and discuss just the flow mat of that and the particular part on the end about forming committees and what their responsibilities were. They're all on that document to make clear to everybody what it is that the superintendent is going to be asking, if necessary, there along that line, and the process that's going through in the hiring of that. So that group passed that on and said that should take care of everything that we think we need to have without having nuts and bolts along that line. So that'll be on the website for those that just want to know the process.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You have a question?
Yes, I do. So the question is, when that is on the website, if the public has questions about clarity on those regulations, who should those questions be addressed to?
The people that are responsible, the process by which that, if it should be for those, when you said a public, somebody that's going through the process, if they have questions?
No, someone reading the process.
If somebody reading the process along that line, well, those, they can understand it, and I'm just trying to say, the administrative regs is how the administrators are saying, we're going to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so you can ask a question. I mean, you can ask a question here or you can ask a question somewhere else, but whether any action will come out of that, that may be a different story, because you can see around the district, there are many questions to be asked by everybody that look at some that I desire to have it this way or that way. But what we can do is take that question and says, wait a minute, is there something out here that's placed someone, a group or individuals at a disadvantage that won a policy change, a regs change, and we'll be more than happy to look at it that way.
She's asking
when she reads it.
Answer her question.
Oh, wait,
it's a much easier question, Leanne. You come here.
Yeah,
you come
here. Bruce answered my question.
And the other question is the only way to judge it is, do the administrative regs comply with the policy? Because if they do, then the administrators have done exactly what it is they're supposed to do.
Okay.
Until we can see it, we'll have no way of knowing that. But I'm hoping we'll see it next month.
But the other thing she's asking is, if she sees that document and she doesn't understand what's happening in that step, what's the process, who does she call? She can't call us because we don't know where it is. So
that's true, but then the only avenue the public, you know, in terms of calling, we have a HR director here, and if time permits or whatever, you say you got a question about something, you can ask that question. I mean, along that line, that's everybody, right?
So the answer is, it comes back here.
It can come back here or.
And then my other
Or the superintendent's
office. Or the superintendent's office. So that's for that, along that line. So
one more?
Sure.
Yes, go ahead.
Thank you. I sent you an email. Would really like to have clarity on what happens when a policy is not adhered to. What is the public's recourse?
Mm-hmm. That's a good one that you may want to ask. I'm trying to see who would. If you have a policy, and there's laws in the state law, if we have policies to provide by, and it depended on who it is, and you're saying whether a school board follow a policy, then and the school board finds out that they made an error in something, they are corrected. Along that line, if an individual in the district, in terms of administrators and so forth, have made an error, we'll make that whole with that error if it's not been followed along that line, whatever the discipline part in terms of administration's personnel that's employed by the district. So when it comes to school boards, and you said, well, there is a process and they follow that. It's not an intent not to follow some. So I don't know what actions that would be really.
If a policy requires certain action and that action isn't followed.
An error. And if we find it out, you make that known, and it's to be followed. That's all. And that's the policy.
But we have no authority as a policy committee to issue discipline or anything else.
No.
She has to go up the ladder.
May I speak?
Yes.
If you just look at the policy that we just finished, it always directs it to the SVSU board of directors. So I would think that was the bottom line.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
And if a school board that's supposed to be like the SVSU doesn't follow it, you have to take your own. It's a right of private action usually at that point. But hopefully we don't ever get to that stage.
Right. So it's more difficult than what everybody, in terms of doing all these things, it's a more complicated system out there than the individual may think in trying to do these things. And so errors may occur, you know. And so as we find and learn, we fix and correct and do. That's all.
Okay.
The other FYI that was out here was the Vermont School Boards Association and its policies, and it's a list that they make a list up, and they have all the required policies. Oh, Lisa's got it up there. She's got the site already up and so forth on that. So,
but when you come here, if you want to see them, you scroll all the way down to the bottom. They have them broken out in three categories: required, recommended, and things to consider.
Right.
Right.
And that's one of the things that we go off of when it comes to this. We said, well, we want to make sure we get all our required, and we want to get the recommended. And then somebody comes up and says, you know, I want to have a policy this way, and the district think we need to have that policy, then we make that policy to be part of the agenda items and curriculum. And so forth. So that's the process. I mean, we try to adhere to all of those and have all of those. So if we missed any, the part that we're doing is as part of this committee, is we're going through all of our required policies to make sure that we've had a chance to look at them, and then going on to the recommended policies. And we're going to systematically do that. And if someone have a policy that needs to jump up or bump up, we'll get that and put that in the process. If you want to know what we're doing, I meet with Lisa and Donna, and we'll set the agenda, go through some of the policies and things before we come here, and then we put out the agenda, and that's what we're going to discuss this night. And we take that information from all around SVSU, but we take it and follow that process in. Okay.
And I think we were really looking at this as a kind of a review process instead of just looking at what's the oldest policy that we have.
Right.
Frank, if something's 30 years old, that doesn't mean we need to consider it. We really need to consider what are the most important policies first, and then
absolutely
look at what we have, check the dates, make sure they're up to date, and then move on so that we have a regular process of review.
Right, because if you're looking at some of those policies out there, and I know the word that says annually goes through them, ask us to try to do things annually, and then I look at the list there, and it's hey, they got some dates on them. Mm-hmm. You know, it's too many to process, you know, in a year's time to say we're going to go through all of them and put them through all of the districts out here as a warning and an adoption process with all the comments that somebody wants to make on certain policies if they had an opportunity to do it. So thank you, Lisa, for showing that, and we'll continue to show how technology has made things available to us right at our fingertips. We get an opportunity so that those that are at home will be able to sit down and just go to these particular things and just knock yourself out.
And thank you, Leon, for addressing where the policies are at the last SVSU meeting. I think that was helpful for people on the board and people at home to know where they can find things on the website.
Well, thank you. So with that, I think our business.
I just want clarification before you close.
Okay.
The curriculum policy, it's built to engage the school boards so they understand. All the schools have had continuous improvement plan. I call it the action plan for improvement.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
To see how it's doing, to have something in front of you. It says
the standards. Obviously.
Am I interpreting something wrong? But to me, it looks like a board is supposed to be involved and approve the plan for accountability.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what we should be doing?
We're saying at the level that
I'm just any board.
Yes.
Board. I'm talking.
That's correct. That's correct.
You're a school board member.
And we have a plan presented to us.
You should be voting on it.
That's correct.
As a board.
As a board.
Take action that we agree and we want.
That's correct.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Okay.
And the reason for that is if somebody has a disagreement or thinks that you're not following it, they go to you.
And what I'm specifically talking about is like every board had a action plan come to them, give you a great presentation, but we forgot to follow through and approve it so that down the road.
So, yeah, okay.
You need to vote on it.
We need to vote on the plans for that. And if you miss it 1 month, you get it the next month.
Okay.
That's all.
So I'm waiting. It could still be coming.
Well, that's what I'm saying. We're going to get a plan out here. And if you're aware of a plan that got missing or something along that line, then
it was presented to every board.
Every
board meeting had their presentation.
We did have the presentation. Moved to be adopted.
They usually just moved to accept the presentation.
So let me make sure, without having all this go back and a lot of confusion, because there's a lot of question and so forth along that line, to make sure that the plan for the district SVSU is presented to all of the boards, and if for some reason somebody may or may not have been there, but all of the plan has to leave the board with the consensus of a vote to take place. Now, if you know that there is a document out there where something didn't, you can just know that we can notify that board and say, wait a minute, it may be an error, it might have been a typographic error, who knows? But the plan was presented. And the gist of the problem is there is a plan to be put in place and looked at and agreed to.
Happened,
okay, and but so and there's no way around it.
Yep, the board shall, not will, may, might, or may.
Right. You should be approving the plan at least in the minimum portions. That's what I read this to say.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to be able to show in your minutes that you have actually done that. And
we agree to it.
That's what I would say.
Right, and so we all agree, and so I'm saying yes.
Yes.
Okay, and I just want to know.
Yes.
That's in there, and if it's something that's wrong with something action that's taken place, let's notify that board and let's get it done.
No, it's
not
like that.
Okay.
It's throughout.
So I'll have you take that back and let them know that some reason it didn't happen, and they'll be more than happy to get it back out there.
You might want to do it at SVSU because it pertains to all the boards.
So Sure. We'll, I thank everybody for coming here tonight, and we'll move on. I like these nameplates out here, and we want to pretend to be sharpening our pencil.
Very professional.
So thank you, everybody, for coming. Thanks.
Hey, you're welcome.
Yeah.
Frank.
Yes.